is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Good morning and welcome to worship with Vancouver Heights United Methodist Church. My name is Joanne and I get to be the pastor of this amazing congregation. This is our second Sunday of Lent, the last Sunday of February, and this is Eric Chen's 18th birthday. So welcome to worship all of you, and let us begin with our affirmation of faith. I am a beloved child of God, and a beauty to behold. Amen.
Good morning. I have a few quick announcements for you this week. Starting with today is Eric Chen's birthday. So Eric, we want to wish you a happy birthday and let you know that we're thinking of you today. All right. Also on the calendar this week, a reminder to the confirmation class. You are meeting this afternoon at 3 o'clock over Zoom. There is a missions meeting on Wednesday at 6:30 and a finance meeting Thursday at 6:30. And then next Saturday, the Circle of Hope will be meeting at 1 o'clock. Again, all of those meetings are taking place over Zoom, so be sure to reach out if you need an invite link for any of them. I also want to remind you of a book group that's starting up on March 17th. The book is called Cast by Isabel Wilkerson, and Deb Avery will be leading that discussion, so please reach out to her if you'd like to be included. If you need help finding a book or if you have a book that you'd like to share, also contact Deb Avery. Her information was included in this week's announcements that were emailed out. I was also asked to let you know that the March and April edition of the Upper Room devotionals are available. If you'd like a copy, you can coordinate with the church office to pick one up or ask for one to be delivered. Either way, just let the church office know that you're interested. The March newsletter, The Bell Ringer, was finished this week, so be sure to take a look at that to stay informed and up to date with everything going on at the church. You can also find it on the church website, or a link was posted to the Facebook page as well. A big thank you to Cheryl for all of the hard work she puts into that and getting that ready for us each month. Next on the list is birthday parades. Looking at the calendar, we have a lot of birthdays coming up this month, which means a lot of opportunities to plan and participate in some drive-by birthday parades. I know that our members really enjoy them, and they are a lot of fun, so if you'd like to be included in the notifications that get sent out, be sure to ask the church office to add you to that list for notifications. And finally, I want to encourage you to take a look at the announcements that were emailed this week, because there are two important updates in there. The first is an address change for one of our young members, Connor Ball. He is in the military and stationed in Georgia, and his new address was included in the announcements that were emailed this week. So I'm sure he'll enjoy getting any cards or words of encouragement that you send his way, so I encourage you to do that. The other update is more information on the Reimagining Life Together, which is the phased approach for opening our church doors. So there's good information in there. You'll definitely want to read that for an update this week. All right, that's all I have for announcements this week. We do have quite a few birthdays and anniversaries to recognize. Tomorrow, March 1st, is Sam Stellini's birthday, followed by Julie Johnson on the 2nd. The 3rd is Monty Brockman's, Lori Ritchie's, and Diane Steele's birthday. And then next Sunday, the 7th, is Pastor Sione and Wynette Saylor's birthday. So a happy birthday to all of you, and also a happy anniversary to Gail and Gary Antijunti, whose anniversary is tomorrow, the 1st, as well as Lynn and Linda on the 5th, and Wayne and Stephanie Roche on the 5th as well. All right, that's all I have for you. Stay safe, stay healthy, stay in touch. Take care, everyone, and have a great week.
Hey, everyone. Today, our story from the Complete Illustrated Children's Bible is called The Expensive Perfume, and it's based off Matthew 26, Mark 14, and John 12. One evening, shortly before Passover, Jesus was dining with his disciples and friends in Bethany. Mary came up to him carrying an expensive jar of perfume. Kneeling before him, she carefully poured the perfume on his feet, using her own hair to wipe them. The whole house was filled with the wonderful fragrance. Some started to scold her, for the perfume could have been sold to raise money for the poor. Jesus hushed them. "She has done a beautiful thing," he said. "You will always have the poor, and you can help them anytime you want. But you will not always have me. People will remember Mary's kindness to me." For Jesus would not be with them in this way much longer. The final stage of his time on earth was about to begin. As you may have heard, we are in the season of Lent. Lent is the 40 days before Easter where we reflect and prepare for the Easter celebrations. Watching church and reading Bible stories like this helps us do that together. In today's story, Jesus knew his time on earth was coming to an end, but he was still teaching others about God's love. Jesus was eating a meal with his disciples and friends when all of a sudden, a woman named Mary came up to him with a jar of very expensive perfume. Carefully, she poured it on Jesus' feet and then wiped it off with her hair. Why do you think she did this? When the other people saw Mary do this, they questioned her, saying she could have sold the perfume to make money for the poor. But Jesus hushed them. Jesus knew this was Mary's way of showing him how much she loved him. Mary showed her love by giving Jesus some expensive perfume. There are tons of ways to show your love for Jesus and God. I want you to think of ways you could show your love. For example, you could draw a beautiful picture to honor Jesus. You could show your love by helping others. Or you could say a prayer to Jesus and God and tell them you're thankful for them. These are just a few examples, but whatever way you can think of to show your love for Jesus is just right. Please join me in an attitude of prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
She made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." She came through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard, as she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. On him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You were there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. And I spent my days, poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And I've come to I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You were there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me.
Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Mark, chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." And this ends today's scripture reading.
The Lord be with you. So here we are, second week of Lent. We've moved from the very beginning of the Gospel of Mark, right up to the center, which is where Stephanie just read about Peter and Jesus and the disciples and what's going on with the cross. And then we fast forward with Joanne's song still in the back of our minds, the woman with the alabaster jar, the woman who had a gift for Jesus. Let's start with that. This is a woman who has been identified as perhaps one of the Marys, either Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, or perhaps Mary Magdalene. This woman who has interrupted a scene in Bethany, interrupted a meal, a gathering of disciples, a woman who has come forth to offset a season where we have many people upset with Jesus, temple authorities throwing hatred at him. In the Gospel of John especially, we're preparing for Judas to betray Jesus. And in the midst of all of this, we have a woman who's coming and sharing a priceless gift. And not just a gift that is worth a lot, but a gift that cuts straight to the spiritual core of this point in time. For this woman, whoever she was, this may have been her dowry. This may have been the key to her future life. She may have just poured out her future on this man that has meant so much to her. She may have given it all. In fact, most likely she did. And we believe she gave it out of love and out of admiration and because it was all that she could do. We know that there were those who wanted to stop her, who had their own thoughts about what she was offering, who wanted to use it for their own purposes. Wouldn't it be nice? Here, Mary, give us your gift, and we will do something else with it. And she would not be detoured. Joanne Boncato would have not been stopped. She was determined to share this song with us as her offering to God, as each of us has tried to do during this season of videotaped worship, not knowing whether you're going to like or not like anything we have to offer to you, but hoping that if we give you our best, it will be pleasing to God, and in that God will bless you. Certainly, Jesus was blessed by the gift this woman offered to him. And he says in the Gospel of Mark that we will talk about this. We will continue to talk about the sincerity and the extravagance of this gift. And we will be reminded that we will not let others interfere with what we have to offer and the spirit in which we give God our best. Let's go back then to what we want to talk about with Peter and the other disciples. We have just witnessed, if we are in the eighth chapter of Mark, we have just witnessed the feeding of the crowds, and we have Jesus pulling aside Peter and looking at him and saying, "Now, what do you think people are saying about me? Do you think they're understanding what I'm trying to do?" And Peter flatly says, "You are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God," which is the right answer. And Jesus is ever so pleased, it seems, that Peter has gotten this far. But then the gift of awareness is not necessarily for Peter to take and use as he will. For Peter wants to take this gift and the presence of Jesus, all that Jesus has, all that he represents, wants to use that for his own purposes, as everyone else did. He wanted to have Jesus be one who would maybe take over the ruling of government and make it a more peaceful place, a more fair place in which he could live. Perhaps he had other aspirations. Perhaps he wanted Jesus to live a good long life so that they could continue to meet the needs of the crowds. But Jesus had his own plans. And that was a hard one for Peter. It's a hard one often, I think, for each of us to take to heart and to live into what God may want with our lives, with our church, the lives that God has given us, the church that God has given us, the mission that we share with God. And so there's also this awkward thing about taking up your cross and following God. It seems connected somehow. We know that the disciples in the day that would follow Jesus, many of them would die themselves upon a cross. We know many of them would suffer for sharing the stories that they knew. Does that mean that Jesus came just so that he could die, which is the inevitable result of what many Christians believe? God sent Jesus so Jesus could die, so we could live, and that is the purpose that we have. And many of us have been wrestling with perhaps the purpose was his life. Perhaps the purpose was that God loved us so much, God would be with us. And God would stand with us, and God would help us to embrace God's world. And the inevitability of that would be that there would be obstacles in the way, but that Jesus would overcome those obstacles, that Jesus would not let people define him or the gift that he had to offer. And because of that, there would be an inevitable death. And the death on that cross is the death of Jesus, who is also God. So God, yes, did give God's self because God loved us that much. However, that doesn't mean that the only thing God gave us was a few hours on the cross or the 2 or 3 days after the fact. God gave us a lifetime of Jesus' teachings. A short life, but a full life. An opportunity to see other people as God sees them. Full of opportunity, full of grace, full of wonder. And how do we, as a church, how do we, as disciples, take up our crosses and follow God? Perhaps it is just as simple as digging in deep to where we are and to what we have been given, and not letting anyone stop us. I have been asked, what will we want to keep the same once we resume life as it was before? Well, I hope that we will continue to preach our messages, to teach our words, to share our music for the purpose of glorifying God, hoping that it will help those who are witnessing it, but that our first and utmost priority will be to give God the very best of what we have. I hope that we will continue to look at this bigger world around us and not necessarily only the people that we see on a Sunday morning. I hope that we will be able to go a little deeper into our needs and our wants than just being together, but wanting a wholeness about our togetherness, wanting a peace about our world that will sustain us through future times that are limiting. I had an interesting dream this week that I have not yet shared with our trustees, but I have shared with a number of other folks. I had a dream that our church was meeting on Easter Sunday, And it was an interesting array of people because our church was meeting and I could see, I could look out and I could see grass and I can see the school and I could see the neighborhood. And then I realized somebody had removed the roof from our sanctuary and had removed the walls. The stained glass was still there, but the pews were out in kind of a meadow setting. And I could see our neighbors in the pews, but I could also see workers around. So we had all of these lovely trucks and work vehicles, and the people that had been doing that work were with us in worship. We were a church that it was in the world and bringing new life to the world. And the world was joined with us in our worship and in our ministry. I think that's a pretty good dream, actually. I think there are ways to pull that off without any major demolition or destruction around here. But I do think that there is something to be said for grabbing on to these challenges that Jesus puts before us. Do we take this gift of unconditional love and grace only for ourselves and for what we need and want in the moment? Or are we willing to push through? Are we willing to give of ourselves specifically to God, which means whatever God might want and need for us? I want to thank Mike Niehaus. He's doing an amazing job as our lay leader under these very strange times. He has given us solid messages consistently, and we will close our worship today with another message from our lay leader. And so enjoy that, and join me now in a prayer. Gracious Heavenly God, we give you thanks and praise for who you have created us to be. And Lord, I trust that in this season of brokenness and in this season of displacement, that you have fine-tuned us to be beautiful instruments, a chorus to sing your heavenly praise. And so, Lord, touch our hearts, our minds, and our spirits, and draw us to you, and help us to draw the world into your embrace. In Jesus' precious and holy name I pray. Amen. Have a great week.
Hello, church family. My name is Michael Niehaus. I am lay leader here at Vancouver Heights. I'm with you today to offer a special Lenten moment. As we focus on Lent this year, I want to take a moment to talk about the brokenness of our political division and the challenges and opportunities it presents in our lives and the life of the church. Differences in political opinion outside and inside of the church are nothing new, but certainly nothing in my lifetime and no time I have read about in our history has caused such pain and brokenness as our current political climate. One survey finds that more than half, 57% of Protestant churchgoers under 50 say they prefer to go to church with people who share their political views. And few adult Protestant churchgoers say they attend services with people of a different political persuasion. The study finds Methodist churchgoers are more likely to agree politically than churchgoers from other denominations. But what can or should we do to keep the divisiveness growing so profoundly in our country from affecting our church family? Perhaps, at least here at Vancouver Heights, we can focus on the core values we all share as a church. The things that have brought us together are the things that can hold us together and even help heal the brokenness that is so pervasive outside our church family. Maybe we can be the example for how others around us in our community, country, and world should act and interact with each other. And what kind of example should we set? What are the things we as a church can model for those in the world outside our church? What are those core values we all share that bring us together in that blessed tie that binds? Here is an excerpt from the Book of Resolutions of the United Methodist Church. The United Methodist Church believes God's love for the world is an active and engaged love, a love seeking justice and liberty. We cannot just be observers. So we care enough about people's lives to risk interpreting God's love, to take a stand, to call each of us into a response, no matter how controversial or complex. The church helps us think and act out a faith perspective, not just responding to all the other mind makers up that exist in our society. Now, there is a core value we should and could model. Perhaps a way we could be brokenness healers. And here are just a few things from our United Methodist social principles. On the natural world, all creation is the Lord's, and we are responsible for the ways in which we use and abuse it. On the social community, we affirm all persons as equally valuable in the sight of God's sight. We reject discrimination and assert the rights of minority groups to equal opportunities. On the economic community, we claim all economic systems to be under the judgment of God, no less than other facets of the created order. On the world community, God's world is one world. We pledge ourselves to seek the meaning of the gospel in all issues that divide people and threaten the growth of world community. These are just a few small excerpts from our social principles. There are, of course, many more. I encourage you to refamiliarize yourself with them. They are what binds us together. But I will share one more on the political community. We hold governments responsible for the protection of people's basic freedoms. We believe that neither church nor state should attempt to dominate the other. Before I end in prayer, I'd like to remind us of one more value that is probably much more familiar to you, something that binds our specific faith community together, something you may see or hear a lot, but something that is in our hearts and in itself capable of mending so much brokenness. Vancouver Heights United Methodist Church publicly affirms its ministry with the whole family of God and intentionally welcomes every person, regardless of race, gender, age, sexual orientation, family situation, national origin, ethnic background, handicapping condition, or economic status. Will you pray with me? Creator God, you did not design us for division, did not build into us hate or loathing for our siblings, yet we are broken. We are not living up to our God-given potential. We pray for a healing to our brokenness. We desire nothing more than to exist together as you have created us to, as you have sent your Son to teach us to. We seek only to live as you would have us live, together as brothers and sisters, without malice or prejudice, where love rules our hearts and dictates our actions. We pray for the strength and clear vision to but live as we were designed to live. This is the way you made us. It is at our very core. Help us to realize the potential we have built into us. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.